This is the NACOcast, an NAC podcast. In this edition of the NACOcast, Nick talks with Principal Pops conductor Jack Everly about the works of George Gershwin and his role in the development of American music. And now, the NACOcast.
George Gershwin's music straddles the classical popular divide that defines so much American music. During his short life, Gershwin wrote an amazing number of works that have become classics of their type. Porgy and Bess is, arguably, the great American opera. Rhapsody in Blue and the Concerto in F have become staples of the piano solo literature. An American in Paris, that great musical portrait of an era, brings to mind not just the movie with Gene Kelly, but reminds us of all the American artists and writers, including Gershwin himself, who traveled to Europe in the 20s and 30s. Then there are the songs, hundreds of them. Back in 1961, my high school music and drama department put on George Gershwin's Girl Crazy. I wasn't playing an instrument yet, but I volunteered for the stage crew. Of course, Girl Crazy is one great tune after another. It was mesmerizing. 15 years later, just after I began playing with the NAC Orchestra, we did a production of Porgy and Bess with the Houston Grand Opera. It was a fantastic production, recorded a short time afterwards in New York with the same singers, but, sadly for us, a different orchestra. Playing and listening to these wonderful tunes makes you realize how great a place they hold in our collective musical cultural experience. In fact, it's no great stretch to compare the influence of Gershwin and his great songwriting contemporaries with the masters of 19th century lieder. The biggest difference between them, to my mind, is that Schubert, Schumann, Brahms, and company were inspired by poets like Goethe, Heine, and Schiller. The lyrics of Cole Porter and Ira Gershwin, clever though they are, make no pretense to that sort of greatness. But the music of George Gershwin and his contemporaries, rooted in jazz rhythms, has become a rich mine of inspiration for the players and composers who came afterwards. Leonard Bernstein and Stephen Sondheim spring immediately to mind. And the most influential jazz players, including Duke Ellington, Charlie Parker, and Miles Davis, have paid homage to the music of their great predecessors. This week at the NAC, we are playing three concerts devoted to the works of George Gershwin. The conductor, our old friend Jack Everly, probably knows more about the history of American popular music than any man alive. So I've invited him here today to talk about George Gershwin and his place in American culture. Jack, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you. Very nice to be here.
I'd like to start things off with an early example of Gershwin's music played by the man himself, accompanying Fred and Adele Astaire. Fascinating Rhythm was written in 1924, the same year as Rhapsody in Blue. Thank you. crazy.
That just makes me smile when I hear it.
So where does all this rhythmic exuberance come from, and how does Gershwin put his stamp on it?
Well, first of all, he was a brilliant harmonist, if you will, and had a way of writing a tune that was eminently singable. Not everyone does. Messiaen may be brilliant, but he can't write a tune to save his life. And George could do this all the time. It's just amazing what he could put together. I think he was the original ADD personality. You know, he was so energetic to the point of jumping on the next project while he was still in the middle of another one, writing the next song when he was in the middle of another one, and he was brilliant on top of it. So it was, if you will, a tipping point of all these dynamics that came together to create this person, this talent we know as George Gershwin. I have to say, it's charming to hear Fred and Adele. Now, Adele was his sister, of course, and Fred and Adele were a dancing and performing team on Broadway. And did a number of shows of the Gershwins, and then I think the final thing they did together was The Bandwagon, the Dietz and Schwartz score. And then she went to London, married royalty, and Fred went to Hollywood and had some sort of career out there.
Mm-hmm. It does sound very madcap, doesn't it?
Yes, and it's actually kind of deceiving when you hear the tune. You think, oh, that's charming, that's sweet. But that's a very tricky rhythmic thing to sing.
I mean, how do you write it for a start?
Well, exactly, yeah.
So, I mean, do you think there's any kind of influence from the earlier piano players like Scott Joplin, Jelly Roll Morton, Fats Waller, any of those guys influenced Gershwin?
Yes. There was such a mixing of popular cultures. I mean, George and all of the creators on Broadway and Tin Pan Alley at that time, of course, would go to Harlem and hear some of the greats that were performing in Harlem, and sometimes only in Harlem because, as you know, segregation and racism was huge at that time, and they weren't even allowed to perform in the Midtown Broadway supper clubs, etc. Mm. There were the occasional all-black shows on Broadway, for example, and that would bring to the very, very, very white culture in Midtown at that time that experience, which was, you know, warmly embraced. They just loved what that was, and it was so new to them at the time. There was everything from Blackbirds of 28 to the Hot Mikado with Bill Bojangles Robinson, and again, with the creative types and the performers, there was such an intermingling that it was both enhanced the other.
I was thinking, you know, about the French connection with Gershwin. A lot of his, you know, when he starts with Rhapsody in Blue, it sounds very, very American. And of course, there's lots of interplay between Europe and America at this time. I'm thinking about Josephine Baker, for instance, in Paris.
She couldn't get hired in America. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the St. Louis-born girl who was basically just kind of tossed about. And so she went to Paris with one of those reviews I was talking about. Mm-hmm. I don't remember if it was Blackbirds or not, but it was one of those that took her over there. And she remained, of course, and became a French star. Even when she came back here to star in the Ziegfeld Follies or her own show, it was not exactly overwhelmingly received. But she was a great lady, I must say. And just that girl from the wrong side of the tracks who made great.
Well, a lot of African-American performers had very good careers in Europe.
Oh, yes,
because
absolutely.
Because there was no hassle at all.
Right, right. You jarred something in my fragile brain when you mentioned the French connection, of course. You know, George went over there to study with Najib Boulanger.
Right.
And that gave him a more firm foundation for orchestration and composition. Mm-hmm. That was a huge help to him. He was enamored of the great symphonists and the talents that were writing symphonic compositions. And I think my memory serves correctly, he actually was asking us, it was either Stravinsky or another of that ilk, basically the question of how can I be as great as you? And he was given the answer, don't even think of it, because you will then be a second-rate Stravinsky when you can be a first-rate Gershwin.
Absolutely.
And he was, George probably had in that realm a slight inferiority complex. He was always trying to write, you know, greater, as it were, and the classical composers of the time, of course, were just thrilled with what he had been composing. They thought, well, this is genius. Mm-hmm. And yet the classical critics of the day were not exactly taken with George's symphonic compositions. They just thought it was more of the Broadway thing, of the influence of jazz and blues and gospel and Broadway, all thrown into a symphonic, today we'd call it smash-up or mash-up, and they didn't get it. And that was part of the reason for the lack of success at the Alvin with Porgy and Bess originally.
It's interesting because the European composers, Ravel, I mean, even Hindemith wrote some swing figures.
You know? Yes. Jazz influenced quite a few things then.
So I was wondering, I mean, he went to study with Nadia Boulanger. I think he also approached Ravel. Mm-hmm. How much cross-fertilization was there? I mean, it wasn't all one-sided, was it?
Oh, no. As you said, the six were all influenced by jazz. Mm-hmm. And you can hear that, Millot and Ravel and you...
Poulenc, probably.
Yes, Poulenc a little bit. It's fascinating to hear the influence with them and how they took it on and in their voices wrote their symphonic compositions. And then you hear how Gershwin was influenced by it. And that's just the brilliance of any of those people is how they then wrote in their voice with that kind of influence.
Now, I know he wrote some string quartets when he was quite young, and he did not, of course, as you mentioned, orchestrate Rhapsody in Blue. How did he learn to be an orchestrator?
Primarily with his studies with Nadia and perhaps a couple other people. Actually, his orchestrations have always been slightly called into question. They got better and better and better and better. Porgy has some kind of murky middle voice stuff that you think, well, that could have been a little bit sharper perhaps as you analyze it. But, you know, as a whole, the drama there is just perfection. And needless to say, the melody and the combination and the characters are so true that that's one of the other reasons why that piece holds up so well.
I was thinking about American in Paris, actually. It sounds, obviously, Gershwin. But, you know, you have these little French echoes in there. And the instrumentation, I find, is quite interesting. It's fairly advanced, I think. I mean, there's lots of brass solos, trombone, trumpet, yeah. Even the tuba has a solo. It seems to me, that there's been a bit of a development in the way he writes.
Yes, he did become more and more sophisticated. That's why it's even more tragic that he died so young. One is thinking, oh, well, he's getting it. He's getting it to be the master at this. And then, of course, his life was cut way too short.
Okay, I'd like to play a couple of selections from Porgy and Bess now, and we'll see what you think of them.
Thank you. It ain't necessarily so. It ain't necessarily so. The things that you liable to read in the Bible, it ain't necessarily so. Little David was small, but oh my. Little David was small, but oh my. He fought big Goliath, who laid down and died. Little David was small, but oh my. Why do? Scat, bat, doodly, the hoop, loop, dilly, it, scat, bat, doot, bat, skilly, bat, scoot, bat, scat, he, wah. Oh, bleed, dam, blood, dilly, bat, dam, flute. Oh, Jonah, he lived in the whale. Oh, Jonah, he lived in the whale. He made his home in that fish's abdomen. Oh, Jonah, he lived in the whale. Little Moses was found in a stream. Little Moses was found in a stream. He floated on water till old Pharaoh's daughter, she fished him, she said, from that stream. Wadu, scat bat dulia, boop dab dublium, skin flat bulia, boot dab bulia, scatty wa. Oh, ulia, ulia, la la duli, billing on a zuli, bala, boot duli, bala, ulia, coo. It ain't necessarily so. It ain't necessarily so. To tell all the chillin', the devil's a villain, it ain't necessarily so. To get into heaven, don't snap for a seven, live clean, have no faults. I takes the gospel whenever it's possible, but with a grain of salt. Methuselah lived 900 years. Methuselah lived 900 years. Who caused that living when no gal were given to no man? What is 900 years? I'm preaching this sermon to show it taint nessa, taint nessa, taint nessa. Taint Nessa, taint Nessa, Sarah Lee. So,
okay, so we've just heard two excerpts. The first with Lawrence Tibbett and Helen Jepsen from a Metropolitan Opera. And they recorded this 4 days after the show opened with an all-black cast. And it sounds pretty white, pretty operatic. Jack, what do you think?
It surely does. Actually, Lawrence had done at the Metropolitan Opera the Emperor Jones opera, in which, of course, as a white man, he played a black man. The film was also Paul Robeson, which is a bit of irony, to say the least. Stylistically, this is fascinating, especially because it was 4 days after the opening, and there is the influence, of course, of George in this. And in that sense, it's all very authentic. And of course, the more true sense, of course, it's inauthentic because it's not a black performer, but we're talking about music in the abstract here. So we're not on stage, we're not doing a character, and we're not seen. One of the reasons George, of course, said no to the Metropolitan Opera was because they couldn't really guarantee an all-black cast originally. And that's another reason why he wanted to put it on Broadway, where they could control the artistic side of it more carefully. Because, just let's face it, like Aida, they would be putting on makeup to create these characters. And George and Ira, and Dubose and everyone associated with it said absolutely not to that sort of thing, thank goodness. And then we hear, of course, the the wonderfully excessive Cab Calloway. Cab, I don't know what marvelous... He was in the character, let's put it that way, and how much ad-libbing and improvising he did for all this. I don't know if he did this in this way on the Breen tour that was throughout Europe. He probably did, and it evolved, because that recording, of course, is not from 1953, and that was right around the time, of course, of that European tour with Leontine Price and William Moorfield, and that's the one that came back to America, where everyone acclaimed George and Ira Gershwin's masterpiece, finally. It's finally everyone got on board with the piece itself. And that was also recorded on RCA Victor and, I guess, Glorious Living Stereo, which is, it's quite something to hear Leontine and William sing that, especially.
They sound fantastic.
Yes, they do. Cool. My favorite sport in life has always been Avon Long. Avon was quite adept at playing the snake known as sport in life. You know, Sammy Davis Jr. sang it brilliantly and acted it brilliantly, too. And I thought what he did in the film was very, very special. But there's something a bit more slithery about Avon Long, that you believe he's the chameleon and he can disappear and he's a survivor. And yet he's one of the most loathsome types ever as a procurer of drugs for anybody who would buy them in Catfish Row. And yet somehow we love him just because he is a survivor.
How do you put this into context? I mean, Gershwin was writing, you know, during the 1930s. There were a lot of very political shows written around that time, including shows by Gershwin himself, of the I Sing, was a satire, I think. Strike at the Band was sort of anti-war. And of course, he has this black dimension. He's writing an opera about, you know, working class African-American people at a time when they couldn't go into a restaurant in a white town. I mean, how subversive, how political was Gershwin?
Well, we must remember, too, that they were creating in that very insular world of New York City and Broadway. And so things could be done there that were progressive and not certainly commonplace in the rest of the country, or maybe even parts of the world at that time, of course. Yes, of the I Sing and Let Him Eat Cake were wonderfully parodies and rather politically subversive. But on the other hand, remember, George was talked into it. George wrote the music, folks. Mm-hmm. George did not write political satire. And one of the things George Kaufman always said was, satire is what closes on Saturday night. Meaning you would open on Monday, and sure enough, nobody would come. So you'd be dead in the water as of Saturday night and close the show. It was a very difficult form. And as you know, these things were rewritten. Strike Up the Band, Of the I Sing, Let Him Eat Cake. These were of varying successes. Fortunately, what we have are these marvelous songs from them. But as shows, when you hear them in these brilliant reconstructed recordings that are out there now by Mal Cherry and John McGlynn, they just sound fantastic. You think, well, gee, why isn't that successful? And then you try to put it together with the script. You think, oh, maybe that's why. It doesn't really resonate, I don't think. And it's clever. But it's clever for enormous fans of the musical theater as opposed to larger audiences.
Well, I guess that's how songs survive. I mean, you don't realize always the context from which they come. You just enjoy the song as it is, as a song.
Which is the genius of being able to have a song resonate within a libretto or a script. It makes perfect sense for the character, and then you take it out of that context, and you can still perform it. And you think, oh, great. That makes perfect sense in that way, too.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's have a song right now. I'd like to play a recording of Kay Davis with Duke Ellington singing Embraceable You.
Grows tipsy in me.
So what do you think about those harmonies?
Beautiful. Just sounds so effortless, like, you know, every note was written that way. Kay had such a lovely voice. So innocent somehow.
When you arrange, you're an arranger as well as a pianist, you can hear Ellington's harmonies. I mean, they're so rich and dark and, you know, Ellingtonian, I guess. There's so much scope. I mean, how do you do it? How do you approach a tune like that if you're an arranger?
Well, it's different for guys like us who are just in the trenches doing, you know, what we are striving to be true to the music and yet make it sound different on the ear. When you're someone like Duke Ellington, of course, you have a sense of genius because it's just innate and it's brilliant. And that's a rare thing indeed. That just flows so seemingly effortlessly. It is a little different. There are, you know, a Broadway orchestrator, for example, is not necessarily also a arranger. And when you get to Duke Ellington's ilk, if you will, that's a composer who just, oh, yes, by the way, I'll take another song and make it brilliant.
So what about Gershwin's tunes? I mean, are they the
sort... I like them.
I like them, too. Are they the sorts of tunes that lend themselves to this kind of stretching and bending and harmonizing? And
I mean, absolutely.
You can do anything with them, and they,
yes,
and they still sound great.
Yes.
It still sounds like Gershwin, but it also sounds like Duke Ellington.
Right.
Is that an attraction, do you think?
I mean, of course.
You know, you hear Miles Davis, Gil Evans, and Porgy and Bess, and I mean, there's so many versions of that tune.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And they're all great. Is that what makes Gershwin so fantastic?
Genius attracts genius, I think. Yeah. And you'll find some of the greatest artists are attracted by the melodic line, and then the harmonic line is what is most often altered.
Yeah.
And you can do marvelous things with it.
So do you think Gershwin holds up better than some of his contemporaries in terms of the way his tunes have been used by various composers and arrangers since?
Better? I'm not sure about better. Better than some, yes, I guess. But, you know, I do think the likes of Cole Porter, Jerome Kern, Irving Berlin, Rodgers and Hart, I believe people can give those songs, when they are great songs, the same sort of magnificent treatment, if you will,
right,
that one gives to a Gershwin melody and lyric, and it just becomes another great thing.
I mean, for me, Cole Porter is the best lyricist, and he wrote his own, didn't he? Does Gershwin, I mean, how does he hold up as a tune writer? Are his tunes more memorable, or is he just sort of in the mix with those other guys?
Gershwin's melodies?
Yeah.
Most often, or very often, he's actually superior. It just kind of depends on what you're looking at. Mm-hmm. Especially when you consider how short a period of time that he was creating. I mean, we're really talking 17 years after Swanee.
Pretty short career.
Yes. And that's all the more amazing when you consider the output and how high the quality is of all that quantity. Mm-hmm. Rather amazing. You mentioned earlier the Cole Porter and Irving Berlin writing their own lyrics and then referencing poets. I'd love to have known what Schubert and Brahms and Heine and all these people, I'd like to know the result if they had actually sat down with the likes of Goethe and each other and tried to collaborate.
To work them out on the spot.
I think there would have been absolute bloodshed in those sessions. That is part of the genius of collaboration, of course. And obviously, George and Ira as brothers had that as a second nature thing going on. But it is one thing in creativity to create music to a pre-existing text or vice versa. It's actually harder if you've got a tune, you put lyrics in, depending upon who you are. And it's quite another to actually create it in the moment with another person.
Absolutely. There must have been a few fights over the years.
I think so.
What about, you know, we talked about Porgy and Bess. I mean, first of all, do you think it's the great American opera?
I think it's one of the great American operas, and there are very few. You know, it's funny that, or maybe ironic is a better word, one of the most severe critics of Porgy and Bess when it debuted on Broadway in 1935 was Virgil Thompson. Mm-hmm. He was also a music critic. Now, don't ask me how a composer who's actively composing would be allowed to be a music critic as well. I don't know what paper he worked for, but I find that wonderfully ironic today. He lambasted Porgy and Bess, which is, you just want to say, Virgil, take a step back now. Don't be jealous. His Four Saints and Three Acts was puttering about at that time, too, and it was considered very wonderfully successful and avant-garde at the time. Today, we look at Four Saints and think, really? What? There's some fascinating things in it, but, you know, really. Virgil has been relegated to quite the back burner, and, you know, time marches on, and we see what truly is genius and successful and all that, and what resonates with the public. But I think the other great American, and if you will, and what George referred to as Broadway opera, that's a very different thing than the great American whatever, is The Most Happy Fella by Frank Lesser. Frank did a very similar thing. He found it somehow innate within his talent to write in a very Italianate way for the great lyrical moments of Tony and Rosabella in The Most Happy Fella. And yet he could write something truly, totally Broadway, very Guys and Dolls, if you will, like Standing on the Corner for the character of Herman and everything in between. He just had that, the genius for that. And of course he wrote his lyrics as well. I mean, that's a true genius, Frank Lesser.
It seems to me that Broadway attracts, though, that type of writer that can write anything, that can write a lyrical, almost operatic line, and then do all these big song and dance numbers as well in the same piece. I mean, there are so many of them. There are so many great Broadway shows. I mean, is that the American art form as far as music goes?
Yeah, I think so. It truly is. I often say that Broadway gave the musical to the world, and that's true. There were, you know, musical reviews and burlesques and pantos and all that, but it's the Broadway musical as we know it today, and as we knew it in its golden ages, and there have been a couple of those, that Broadway gave that art form to the world. They knew how to develop it. They knew how to make it better, constantly working on it. Oh, by the way, another, I think, marvelous Broadway opera is Sweeney Todd, of course.
Yeah.
Candide.
Mm-hmm. Candide.
And Candide was a failure. You know, Porgy and Bess was a failure. Most Happy Fella ran a season and a half, and its ticket sales were bolstered by a marvelous episode of I Love Lucy, believe it or not.
It's hard to believe now.
Yes, it is.
Before we close, I'd like to talk to you about what's coming up. We're doing West Side Story in January, for instance.
That's a marvelous thing because it's the film restored, and it's the film orchestrations restored and rethought. And it's just brilliant because the orchestra plays it live and you see the entire film as it was seen in 1963, I believe. I think it was 63, yes.
So we'll try and keep up.
Yeah. Great score. Great score.
I'd like to close out then by playing a crazy arrangement of Someone to Watch Over Me by Art Tatum. Just when you think that Gershwin can't be stretched any more out of shape, here's Art Tatum.
Thank you.
So would George have approved of that?
Totally. Totally. Oh, that's great.
He out madcaps George.
Yes, he does. That's magnificent. Like, lots of personalities going on in there.
Well, Jack, thanks very much for coming in and sharing your insights.
You are very welcome. This is such a pleasure.
And we look forward to the rest of the run.
Yeah, very much.
Thanks a lot.
You're welcome.
This has been an NAC podcast. You'll find more NAC podcasts, including the NACOcast sister podcast, Explore the Symphony, at nacpodcast.ca. You can easily subscribe to the NACOcast for free by searching for NACOcast in the iTunes Music Store. While you're there, leave a comment, give us a star rating, and subscribe to our other NAC podcasts. Do you love classical music? For free access to over 250 full-length, high-quality recordings of the NAC Orchestra, from Bach to Bartok, check out nacmusicbox.ca, a musical archive spanning the 40-year history of the NAC Orchestra. Send your comments and questions to nacpodcasts@gmail.com. We love to hear from you. That's all for this edition of the NACOcast. I'm Martin Jones. Goodbye for now from Canada's National Arts Centre in Ottawa.